So then let's go into the raw material, Law of One, session 61 for today. And this is 14 exchanges only. It's a short session. I'm not sure if we can do it in an hour. I think so. Received July 8, 1981. Much was focused on Carla's condition and dynamics of the raw contact. And a little bit, though, very critically, on the balancing of body, or the healing and initiation of body, as the second stage of healing and initiation of mind, body, spirit. And what does that mean? Body is not just physical, but it's certainly the working with body, or that level of chakra clearance, clearing chakra blockages associated with physicality, is a critical work, of course. Ra explains it at 61.6 and 61.7 very well. So let's jump in a little bit in brackets. 61.0. I am Ra. I greet you, my friends, in the love and in the light of the one infinite creator. We communicate now. Actually, they said, I greet you, my friends, in the love and in the light of the infinite creator. We communicate now. Don first asked for an indication of Carla's condition. And Ra says, this instrument's vital energies are improving. The physical complex distortions are quite marked at this space-time, and there is a decrease in physical complex energies. So there's a difference between vital energy and physical complex body-related energies. You know, there are seven chakras with seven energy fields. I think that vital energies are associated with the etheric, or six chakra body energy field, while physical complex distortions are probably associated with first, second, third related chakra energy bodies, the energy fields associated with first, second, third chakras in some way. At the higher level, she's strengthening vitally, but at the physical level, she's a bit weaker at this time. Don, as often, asks, is there anything in particular that the instrument could do to improve the physical condition? 61.2, and Ra answers, this instrument has two factors affecting its bodily distortions. This is in common with all those which, by seniority of vibration, have reached the green ray level of vibratory consciousness complexes, meaning heart chakra activation. The first is the given in-streamings, which vary from cycle to cycle in predictable manner. In this particular entity, the cyclical complexes at this space-time nexus are not favorable for the physical energy levels. The second ramification of condition is that which we might call the degree of mental efficiency in use of catalyst provided for the learning of program lessons in particular and the lessons of love in general. This instrument, unlike some entities, has some further distortion due to the use of pre-incarnative conditions. So here at 61.2, Ra is saying that Carla has two major factors affecting her bodily energy conditions or bodily distortions, her physical condition, in common with all of the people here on Earth who buy the logoic plan for seniority in incarnation by vibration. Seniority of vibration means the preference given to souls who can best make use of the current late third density vibratory environment. 3.7 being, in my understanding, like the energetics associated with the end of a third density cycle. Now the planet is yellow green or activated 1, 2, 3, 4, four dimensionally or energetically dimensionally activated, associated with, of course, first, second, third, fourth chakras. And the idea is that the Logos or God and the Council of Saturn has the plan to give preference in the incarnation or seniority to those souls able to best make use of this particular yellow-green environment. the energetics associated with the last subplane or last phase of third density evolution. Then, these two factors that affect all such people or souls. The first is cyclical in-streamings, or the cycles, which Ra will explain in 61.3, cycling in-streamings of energy, or various cycles associated with physicality, emotional, intelligence, and adeptness. So physical, emotional, mental, or intelligence-related, and then magical or spirit-related cycles of energy influence. And they'll explain this more in 61.3. And Ra's saying that at this particular time for Carla, those particular cycles are in their low phase. Secondly, then, also, for her or for anyone, in terms of how our physical levels are, do we walk around exhausted and fatigued, drained and washed out, or with sufficient energy, or bursting with energy, or quite capable and not sleepy, you know, all through the day and able to work or able to do our thing. That measure here is related to what Ra calls degree of mental efficiency in use of catalyst provided for the learning of program lessons in particular and the lessons of love in general. So this is called the efficient use of catalyst, which means how we meet life experience, which means how we react to sensations and changes in our body, bodily conditions, and changes in mind associated with thoughts and feelings, and changes in the environment associated with people and places and situations and groups. So our reactivity, how we react to that, is one measure of, or one aspect of, the degree of efficiency in, you know, use of catalyst, or efficient use of catalyst, which means how well you live your life, including, you know, dealing with your body, dealing with your emotional life, dealing with your thoughts and feelings and memories and hopes and fears and all of that, and dealing or being with other people and groups and society, and then, of course, the choices we make. And so this is the use of catalyst, or life experience, or experiential catalyst, which is provided for or here with us now in our experience, so that we may learn. Learn means grow. Grow means, release lower chakra blockages and develop 4, 5, 6, particularly, you know, qualities of heart, qualities of intelligence, discernment, qualities of will, balance, whole, you know, kind of self-integration, wellness, you know, spiritual, emotional, physical, psychological, in relationship and alone. Those are, you know, that is learning of programmed lessons. Well, that's actually the lessons of love in general. So we have the lessons of love in general, which is the purpose of third density. Ra said the purpose of third density is to learn the ways of love. And that means activate fourth chakra. And that means heal the psychological and the emotional and the physical, but particularly the emotional and psychological. And then we have programmed lessons in particular, meaning each person has their own variations on the theme of love or development of fourth chakra, fifth chakra, which is the particular challenges we face with our body, with our emotional life and psychological history and dynamics, with our relationships, with our group engagements, with the location where we live, financially, physically, psychologically, spiritually, all those ways. Each person has unique variation of challenges at each of those levels. And the more we heal and clear blockages and heal, the more peaceful and smooth the life experience becomes. Then, finally, for Carla, unlike some others, Ra is saying she has further distortion due to use of pre-incarnative conditions. I'm not sure if that means her bodily genetic limitations or issues that she brought in, but I think most people actually have pre-incarnative conditions brought in. But all of those influence how she is. So that's there are countless influences upon us continually. Then Don asked for clarification on this phrase, this term, cycling in streamings of energy. What about the cycles that affect us, or energy cycles affecting us at different levels? And Ra gives the big answer, 61.3. There are four types of cycles, which are those given in the moment of entry into incarnation, meaning based on birth time, date. There are, in addition, more cosmic and less regularized impourings, which, from time to time, affect a sensitized mind-body-spirit complex. The four rhythms are, to some extent, known among your peoples and are called biorhythms. There is a fourth cycle, which we may call the cycle of gateway of magic of the adept or of the spirit. This is a cycle which is completed in approximately 18 of your diurnal cycles, meaning days. The cosmic patterns are also a function of the moment of incarnative entrance and have to do with your satellite you call the moon, your planets of this galaxy, meaning the solar system, the galactic sun, and in some cases the in-streaming from the major galactic points of energy flow. And the note here is saying that the tools that show the adept cycle, in addition to the three biorhythms, are available at a page associated with bringforth.org forum, and I'll send you the link here, and it's useful to check yourself. If I see myself for today, April 19, I see all my rhythms are trending down, and my intelligence is 61% below zero, and my adeptness is 64% below zero. Oh well. So what does that mean? I can't speak? I don't know, but I'll do my best. Four types of cycles related to birth date and time. Now, of course, related to location, but that's different. These four types, akin to biorhythms, begin with physical, then emotional, then mental or intelligence related. The fourth is adeptness, which Ra explains. Then you also have cosmic or less regularized impourings from what? From the constellations? From other stars? From other galaxies? Well, all of that's included. More cosmic, less regularized, which affect a sensitized mind-body-spirit complex. So the person who's done more spiritual work is sensitized in the spiritual path as a development of sensitivity. As we keep growing and developing, we become more sensitive, however, not simply emotionally sensitive, but also sensitive to wisdom or truth, and sensitive to the emptiness or insubstantiality of thought, sensitive to anicca anatta dukkha, sensitive to time and the temporal function, which is, I may be miserable now, but time shall pass, or there is such a experience as time passing and change, anicca, impermanence, and based on that, I can be patient, or I know that what occurs now will shift and relates to what occurs later, and I know that what occurs now is related to what came before it, at least in my limited experience of linear time. That's another form of sensitivity. So, sensitivity at all levels needs to be developed, not only emotional sensitivity, of course. So, these four rhythms akin to biorhythms, you can see it on that page, physical, emotional, mental, or intelligence-based, then also fourth cycle, which is written as adeptness, or the cycle of gateway of magic of the adept, or of the spirit. The cycle of magic gateway. The gateway magic, or gateway magical cycle for adepts, or associated with spirit complex, 6th and 7th chakra. The adept is the one who's done enough work in clearing 1, 2, 3 and developing 4 and 5 so that they're mainly working from or with an integration or synthesis of 1 through 6 and 1 through 7. All chakras are in play more so than before. This includes spirit complex associated with 6 and 7 chakras and the head, the light in the head. That cycle pertains more to people who are doing spiritual work or working with six chakras somehow in daily life. That is an 18-day cycle. So one can check that out on the page and calculate. Then when Ra talked about cosmic patterns, they're saying it's also related to when we're born, the moment of incarnative entrance. They also have to do with the moon and the planets of the solar system, Ra said, of your this galaxy, that's sometimes used for solar system, and galactic sun, which means the center of the galaxy, or Milky Way, and even in-streamings from major galactic points, that means what? Major portions of this galaxy? Probably. So we have in-streamings associated with the moon and its cycle. The planets, which is, you know, all of that's covered somewhat by astrology. The galactic sun, or the central spiritual sun, the center of the galaxy, like the photon belt and other energy influences or transmissions from galactic center, which is particularly important now, actually, as Earth and the planets of the solar system as a whole are in transition energetically, associated with the movement of the solar system around galactic center, then also other major galactic points. So, obviously, there are many influences upon us continually. And for the one who's spiritually developing and becoming more sensitive at all levels, hopefully, one may be affected more or in certain ways subtly by them. But you can see, you know, my adeptness and my intelligence levels are 61%, 64% below zero today. Does that mean I can't speak? No, I don't think so. Does it mean, how does it affect me? Well, I don't know. I just do my best. So I don't think we should get hung up on cyclical influences. And in terms of, you know, there are some New Age folks who say, oh, everything's different, or did you feel that big wave? It started September 11, 11/11, or, you know, it's November 11. Did you feel it? It's a new wave of energy. For me personally, I'm not really interested in cyclic energy influences, although astrology is great, and we can learn a lot from it, actually. But, like Nityananda said about a woman who had a very malevolent Saturn configuration in her chart associated with death and dying young, to her husband or family that came to him asking for help, he said, yes, Saturn is here, but God is here too. God is here also. And it was very interesting. He actually recommended very strange rituals for the woman or the family to do. And she did them. And by that, she didn't die on that day, even though all the Vedic astrologers were telling her, that's it for you. And so, you can, you know, think the whole thing is poppycock, but the planets are beings. They are sub-beings below the Logos. They are gods. In the old, you know, mythologies, the planets are gods. There is some truth to that. There is a personality, or there are what could be understood as human personalistic qualities to the energies of the different planets and constellation, like Mars versus Venus versus Neptune. They do have influences, and they can be understood personalistically, in that, you know, the god of Mars and the god of Aries. But these are real factors. But God is here too. Or one can be, not be hobbled by you know, cosmic influence, if one is really centered in God, in the One, to whatever extent we can. Okay, going on, 61.4. Would it be helpful to plot the cycles for the instrument and attempt to have these sessions at the most favorable points with respect to the cycle? Ra said, to that specific query, we have no response. Different than saying the law of one is invoked, or, you know, the law of free will shouldn't be violated and I won't tell you. No response, maybe because the whole dynamic of according our life with cycles versus according our life with truth, or our true being, discernment, love, essence, are different approaches. And I think it's better to, you know, make your mind to make your mind as much in harmony with Atman as possible. And, you know, it's just very slow work. It doesn't mean be goody two shoes. Do what you can, but to make one's life in accord with one's mind, or make one's mind and one's life and one's fate one, then one does one's best and cycles come and go. So these are two different approaches, and Ra didn't say, yes, you should plot the cycles and have our sessions on those dates, because that's not a that's not the high road, actually. You know, surrendering to cycles or conforming to cycles is not the way. But doing our best is more centered, I think. Anyway, Ross says, to that specific query, we have no response. It may be noted that the three in this triad, meaning Don, Jim, Carla, bring in this energy pattern, which is Ra. Thus, each energy input of the triad is of note, meaning each person in the group is important, not only Carla. We may say that while these information systems are interesting, meaning of cycles, they are in sway only insofar as the entity or entities involved have not made totally efficient use of catalyst, and therefore, instead of accepting the, shall we say, negative or retrograde moments or periods without undue notice, have the distortion towards the retaining of these distortions in order to work out the unused catalyst. It is to be noted that psychic attack continues upon this entity, although it is only effective at this time in physical distortions towards discomfort. We may suggest that it is always of some interest to observe the roadmap both of the cycles and of the planetary and other cosmic influences, in that one may see certain wide roads or possibilities. However, we remind that this group is an unit. We remind that you are one, and all is one. And that's the high road. That's the superior way, and that's what Nityananda said. God is here too. Saturn is here. There are cycles. There are planetary and other cosmic influences. There are astrological configurations at birth, yes indeed. One may see them as certain wide roads or possibilities or tendencies or karmic opportunities and limitations, sure. But the law is one. This group is one. This group is a unit. All is one. One is all. God is here too. I think that's Ra's perspective, in accord with Nityananda, or they're in accord with him. So again, they say here at 61.4, these information systems are interesting. It is interesting to know about the cycles, but from personally, I found a lot of astrology-minded people make such a big deal out of astrology, and they explain everything in terms of astrological influences. And astrology drives them rather than they use it as simply one system and one perspective among many. But it is not ultimate. And that's what Ra is saying here. These systems are interesting, and they are in sway or relevant only insofar as entities or a person or one has not made totally efficient use of catalyst. Now, of course, none of us have made totally efficient use of catalyst. So they are in sway for all of us, more or less, to the degree we haven't made totally efficient use of catalyst, meaning to the degree that we still have distortions or chakra blockages or imbalances. So as we all do have chakra blockages, distortions in mind, imbalances, and all sorts of things like that, then these systems of information, which is really the cycles of energy influences, the biorhythms, physical, emotional, intellectual, or mental, the adept cycle for spirit complex activity, the moon and the planets and the constellations and the galactic center and other galactic points, they are in sway for all of us, more or less, but particularly more so to the degree we haven't used catalyst well. And so Ra is explaining in another way here, the second paragraph, 61.4, what does it mean to not have made totally efficient use of catalyst, which again is the case for all of us, more or less. What does it mean, not made totally efficient use of catalyst? What does it mean? Well, what it means, I think, is that instead of, well, not totally efficient use of catalyst means one has the distortion to the retaining of distortion. There are two approaches shown here to dealing with all those energy influences and cycles, cyclic energy influences. One is accepting negative or retrograde moments or periods without undue notice. The second way is having a distortion towards the retaining of distortion in order to work out unused catalyst, meaning attached to my distortions. I mean, why do we have distortions? Because we're attached to them, because we hold them tight. We're self-bound. We're self-binding those distortions. Well, of course, how are they released? We detach by the desire to be free. I mean, how is any freedom achieved? By a persistent effort to be free, to detach, to not retain distortions, to let go, to surrender to what is, to accept and love and know and forgive and choose better. But we're stuck because we choose to be stuck. We're stuck because we hold our stuckness. We retain patterns of anger, volatility, patterns of sorrow, self-pity, patterns of fear, and low self-value, because we're afraid to let them go. But letting go is not done by saying, I let it go. It's actually done by the demonstrated willingness to face the pain that's associated with the presence or pattern, the reality of those patterns in the mind, in the body, in the self. The demonstrated willingness to live in truth, which means to accept, to feel, to be willing to feel the pain of these patterns of anger and sorrow, grief, self-pity, and fear, low self-value. The willingness to feel them and accept them and love ourselves anyway and understand them and then go to forgiveness. Of course, all of that requires taking responsibility. All this pain in my life, in my mind, I created. The pain in my body, the pain in my mind, the patterns of limitation, all of this, I made it myself. You know, and Ross said, you know, looking at all the players in the poker game saying, I love you, all you players with all your cards, I love you. Which really doesn't mean I like it, but I accept it, that I made this body, I made this mind, and I can unmake them. And so one, the high road, what I'm calling the high road to spiritual development, is not making a big issue of negative and retrograde moments or periods of cyclic energy influence, but accepting it and moving along, doing your best. And the opposite is holding on to distortions. And so that's actually what's happening when we're when there's a retrograde or negative cyclic influence in play, to the extent that we get knocked down by it, it's because we're retaining our distortions, or we're unwilling, unable to face the pain that we're carrying associated with those distortions and unhelpful patterns. And that is associated with working out unused catalyst. Now, of course, most people who retain distortions are not really much working through, working out unused catalyst, but trying to avoid pain, or trying to avoid certain truths that are felt to be bitter. Anyway, this is a very interesting discussion on the different approaches to the reality of multiple cyclic energy influences upon us, from the environment and from the body itself, you know, the biorhythms and environmental, cosmic, you know, multi-planetary influences, then it's interesting, but one can not get knocked down by cyclic influences. But one may have to make certain strong effort, like that woman that Nityananda prescribed very strange and exotic rituals for, who then didn't die on the date that everybody, all the astrologers were predicting. So, anyway, interesting. 61.5, Don asks, is there some way that we could, as a unit then, do something to reduce the effect of the psychic attack on the instrument and optimize the communicative opportunity? Ra said, we have given you the information concerning that which aids this particular mind-body-spirit complex. Carla, we can speak no further. Ra's answered the same question many times, and Don's asked it many times. It is our opinion, which we humbly offer, that each is in remarkable harmony with each for this particular third-density illusion at this space-time nexus. So, we can speak no further. Ra has given a lot of advice and guidance on how to help Carla and how to return to harmony and balance within each and for the group. And they were doing fine. They just didn't think they were doing fine, or Don felt there was something missing. And that's another interesting matter. And the bird is chanting. See? He just stopped after being recognized. Nityananda talks about some birds chanting, and animals chanting. It is the case sometimes that we are in remarkable harmony, but we think we're not. So it's not total harmony, obviously, because we can't recognize the harmony. But it's very common, actually, for many people, that they are goodly souls, and they are perhaps doing quite well. But they always think there's something wrong. There's something wrong with me, right? There's got to be something wrong with the situation or me, isn't there, always? So this is sort of deep self-mistrust, and people should be careful about that. People could be very well and never think they're well, because you know, the only thing to fear is fear itself, this kind of view. There may be real problems which need to be addressed in one's life or mind, but it often is also the case that things are well, but we can't recognize it. 61.6, and here are the two heart pith questions, and I'll probably spend the next 15-20 minutes about it. 61.6, Don says, I want to ask a few questions Jim had here about the healing exercises. The first is, in the healing exercise concerning the body, what do you mean by the, quote, disciplines of the body having to do with the balance between love and wisdom in the use of the body in its natural functions? This is associated with healing and initiation of body. Ra said, I'll read the whole answer, then explain. We shall speak more briefly than usual. Due to this instrument's use of the transferred energy, we therefore request further queries if our reply is not sufficient. So there are four major paragraphs here. Number one, The body complex has natural functions. Many of these have to do with the unmanifested self and are not normally subject to the need for balancing. There are natural functions which have to do with the other self. Among these are touching, loving, the sexual life, and those times when the company of another is craved to combat the type of loneliness which is the natural function of the body, as opposed to those types of loneliness which are of the mind-emotion complex or of the spirit. Second paragraph. When these natural functions may be observed in the daily life, they may be examined in order that the love of self and love of other self versus the wisdom regarding the use of natural functions may be observed. There are many fantasies and stray thoughts which may be examined in most of your peoples in this balancing process. Third, equally to be balanced is the withdrawal from the need for these natural functions with regard to other self. On the one hand, there is an excess of love. It must be determined whether this is love of self or other self or both. On the other hand, there is an overbalance towards wisdom. Fourth paragraph. It is well to know the body complex so that it is an ally, balanced and ready to be used, ready to be clearly used as a tool. For each bodily function may be used in higher and higher, if you will, complexes of energy with other self. No matter what the behavior, the important balancing is the understanding of each interaction on this level with other selves, so that whether the balance be love-wisdom or wisdom-love, the other self is seen by the self in a balanced configuration, and the self is thus freed for further work. So we've got the body complex with natural functions. Many have to do with what Ra calls the unmanifested self, which I think is the self in solitude, or the self non-relationally, the non-relational self. The self not associated with other people, or not associated with activity, even, but with homeostatic, you know, functions. But there are other ways of looking at that. But Ra is saying that the functions, these many functions of the unmanifest self, which I think is the non-relational self, are not subject to the need for balancing. But of course, you know, how much you sleep and how much you eat and other functions, how much you exercise and other such functions of body alone may be out of whack, out of kilter, sure. But Ra is focusing on the natural functions of body relating to other self, meaning relational, the relational functions of body, or body's functions relational to others, such as the natural functions, such as touching, physical contact, loving, which is heart sharing, body, you know, body to body heart sharing, and sexual life, which is, you know, not, which, there can be touching and loving without sexuality or intercourse, obviously. So we're talking about degrees of intimacy. Touching, tactile, loving, heart, body relation, you know, dual bodies, two physically people, physical together, loving, without sex, and then sex, sexual life, and then company, companionship, that is associated with the body's natural function of loneliness. If you ever see the movie The Martian, Matt Damon, who I think is a nice guy and a good actor, the loneliness that he may have felt on Mars, on the planet all alone, although of course there are other beings on Mars, but not in that movie, the loneliness that I could feel, that he might felt, that was, you know, experienced being the only man on a planet in that movie, is akin to this, I think. The type of loneliness which is a natural function of body. This sort of non-echo, the non-feedback of no other human bodies in the desolate wilderness, like, you know, dropped in the middle of a desert, this kind of thing. So that's a body, that's loneliness that comes from the body longing to have another human body nearby, and it's akin to, you know, why animals, you know, birds of a feather flock together. Why does the cow go with the cow and the deer with the deer and the ant with the ant? Well, part of it is a body sympathy, is body sympathetic resonance, not only pheromones and smell, but also energetic resonance. You know, this smells like my family, something like that. Now, there's the other type of loneliness, which is of the mind-emotion complex, or of spirit, the loneliness of spirit. How about that? And that's something that has to be faced in meditation, actually, which is a sort of the sense of all one, meaning all alone. The solitary, the experience of solitude in unity, the unitive, or the unitive experience of solitude. The unified self experiencing solitude or loneliness, whereby there's a sense that there are no other beings in creation but this one here. Then, now the exercise is really the healing and balance of body as a phase of mind, body, spirit, healing and balance. So, the healing and balance of body complex is explained somewhat in the next three paragraphs. First, we can observe these natural functions of body in daily life, meaning what's going on with my physical impulses in relation to others particularly. So we can observe in daily life what's going on with us, what we're doing, how we're feeling in relation to our embodiment or physicality in relation to others. And the first axis of analysis is to see if love of self is to look at the issue of love of self versus love of other self, so the function of love versus wisdom, regarding the use of the natural function. So there's the tendencies, our tendencies in relational, in body relationality, in physical relationality to others, associated with love, and those associated with wisdom. Those associated with love are associated with the love of self and the love of other, different. So there's what I, my physical experience relating to me and my body with some degree of love, and my physical experience relating to others physically in terms of love or no love to them. Then there's the aspect or our tendencies associated with wisdom, which is actually in many cases withdrawal or the opposite of love, wisdom to refrain, as well as maybe confusion or clarity regarding the wisdom to engage. So there's love of self, there's love and wisdom. This is the balancing, right? Balancing love and wisdom. Balancing the tendencies associated with love with those associated with wisdom in relation to others and embodied physical relationship. On the one hand, love can be that which is internal or self-directed love. Then there's love to other, or, you know, love-based body relationality to others. And then there's wisdom-based relationality to others. Okay. Now, in examining in looking at that, Ra is saying you can look at your fantasies and stray thoughts, meaning you see, you know, I see a pretty woman and I want to, you know, embrace her. What is that? Those are fantasies and stray thoughts. What's it about? Well, a longing. You know, that's love of other over wisdom. Meanwhile, I could be in a room and I see some New World Order agent with a tattoo and big forearms, and I think, ugh, disgusting, and I feel revulsion, and I want to leave. So that would be wisdom over love. There's no love of him. There might be a love of me to withdraw, but that's wisdom in rejection of any natural affinity or companionship that might be possible. So again, we're looking at love versus wisdom, balancing our tendencies in physical relationality, associated with the natural functions, in relation to others or relationship. Along the axis of love and wisdom, and then the love has to be understood. We're talking about love of self or love of other. It's a little complicated, and I'm no adept on this. Then we've got Ross saying, equally to be balanced is the withdrawal from the need for the natural functions, right? So there is the fulfillment of the natural functions, then there is the withdrawal from the fulfillment or the need for the natural functions, or the natural functioning, right? These natural functions associated with companionship or intimacy, versus the withdrawal from those natural functions, or withdrawal from the need, or restraint of the need, or rejection of the need, or rejection of the natural functions. That's related to wisdom. Then, on the one hand, Ra said there's an excess of love, meaning excess of love in the withdrawal from the natural functions. Then you can determine whether it's love of self or other self. And then there's overbalance towards wisdom. So the overbalance or excess of wisdom in the need to withdraw from natural functions or need to withdraw from the relational natural functions of body, meaning intimacy and companionship, is exampled, manifest, I think, by the person who, is a misanthrope. And they hate society. They hate humans. So the misanthrope, perhaps, could be manifesting an overbalance towards wisdom, who has excessively withdrawn from the need for natural functions, or excessively rejected natural functions, or used wisdom as a means of suppressing perhaps their natural love. I'm just saying these manifestations of rejection of relationality may manifest excess wisdom in motivation. And so it's all very complicated, but we can look at how we're relating to others, how we're withdrawing from relating to others, by our fantasies and stray thoughts, or by our life, you know? How do you live? Do you live enmeshed with people? Do you live solitude? Are you afraid of being in a group? Do you love being in a group? Do you need being in a group? Do you need people wanting to be with you? Do you need to have companionship, or the TV on, or the radio on, or somebody calling all the time? Or do you hate that? Or do you accept it and you like it and you also can leave it? And you like to be alone, and you like to be with others, and you like intimacy, and you're okay without intimacy. The key is that when there's an emotional charge, there's a distortion. And one can fool oneself and imagine, I have no emotional charge, and that's, rationalization or a defense mechanism. So honesty is important here. But you can see that this goes on and on. So there are natural functions that are associated with intimacy, companionship, and togetherness and engagement. One may find that there's an excess of love of self associated with that engagement. There may be an excess of love of other, like, I need you because I hate myself. Or, I feel good when I'm needed, but I feel bad when I'm not. There is then also the wisdom regarding the use of natural functions. People who perhaps, measure all their calories all the day are excessively using the excessive use of wisdom in their self-care of body. That's perhaps related to the unmanifest self or non-relational self. But anytime there's dominance of mental strategizing or mental calculation in use of body, there's a possibility of excess of wisdom. Anytime that there's an unqualified or unthinking following of the emotional or of the physical desiring in relation to others or relationship, there's a possibility of excess love. But there's the need to be with others, and there's the need to withdraw from others. There's the need to be alone, which is a real need. And then there of body and of mind and of spirit. And there's also the need at the body level, which is what we're talking about here, for, you know, togetherness. So Ra's talking about balancing the natural function needs at the body level alone and in relation to others, according to the axis of love versus wisdom, or love and wisdom. And in the case of love, it's dual, associated with love to self versus or and with love to other. Love for other, meaning some sense of excessive need for other in body relationality of some sort, versus the relationality that's based on some love of self and the degree to which there really is love of self, meaning I need you because I don't like me. Or, I'm happy to be with you because I'm happy to be with me. Or, I like, healthy relationship with anybody whenever we may have it because I like me. And if you like you and you're good-hearted and sincere, then let's have good relationship of some sort. So, it's all very subtle. So there can be excess love, there can be excess wisdom in the relation to others and in the withdrawal from a relationship. And the love is dual in a way that wisdom is not. And that's because fourth chakra is a lower frequency than fifth. And so there's some reflection on the distinctions between green and blue there. And blue partakes of spirit complex while green does not yet. And there are certain functions available when wisdom is well developed that are simply not available when love is developed without much wisdom. Ra said, finally, it's well to know the body complex so that it's an ally, it's balanced, we can use it as a tool, and then each bodily function may be used in higher and higher complexes with other self, meaning, you know, there can be animal fucking sex. There can be, intellectual-based sexuality, like let us do this at the right cycle to make the right vehicle for the incoming soul. And there can be, sanctified, true tantric union, white magic, but even beyond magic, but two sharing their recognition or awareness of unity. Becoming a unified, a fused unity, two becoming one, or the two that know themselves as one, sharing that one in union. So there are all sorts of body functions and body relational functions or relationality with others associated with body to body that can be sanctified or used or refined or ascended in frequency, in vibratory quality associated with higher chakra activation, with others and alone. So whatever the body, whatever the behavior, Ra is saying, the important balancing is understanding each interaction on this level with other selves, meaning body to body, or physical presence, physical interaction, so that whether there's the balance of love over wisdom, or wisdom over love, the other self may be seen by the self in a balanced way, and we're freed for further work. So seeing the other self in a balanced configuration actually means seeing them with balanced love wisdom, which means we accept them as clearly as we see them. We accept them as fully as we know them. And we know them as clearly as we can accept them. Knowing and acceptance are unified. I accept what I know, and I know what I accept. I wish to accept all that's real, and I wish to know it all clearly. So, these days, I understand fourth ray, the full development of fourth ray, green ray, heart chakra, as perfect receptivity, which is a capacity to accept and be with all that is as it is. fifth ray, blue ray, fifth chakra, I would say ideally is perfect reflectivity. The capacity to reflect, to be impressed, and then reflect and express that impression of reality accepted truly, expressed back to the world. So by perfect receptivity or fourth chakra, we may fully or move to fully accept. That acceptance is the capacity for being impressed, meaning reality can impress itself upon us. We can receive and within ourselves configure mind and energy fields to be in resonance with what is in the apparently outside world. That receptivity is a kind of pure impressionability. One can be impressed. Making a stamp. There was one great Chan master in China who used the vermilion, you know, seal. Vermilion, it was a color. Very brilliant master. I think it was might have been Yun Men talking about that in a koan, gongan. But the capacity of love or heart chakra is so well developed that reality can be impressed accurately upon the mind. The mind is a still receiver or impressionable field, which may then reflect that accurately, you know, to the apparent other or in the apparent environment. Like water, still water, can hold or manifest a clear reflection of that which, you know, may appear on its surface. But only by the stillness of the water can that reflection be impressed upon that light impression, right? The environment by light impression may be impressed upon the appearance of the surface of the water, and thereby purely reflecting by that reflection or by that impression that which appears to be the other. And that's, I think, exactly what Ra's saying here with the other self being seen by the self in a balanced configuration. Love, wisdom, balanced allows that pure reception of the other self as it is, and a pure reflection by words, skillful activity, upaya, skillful means, reflected back in a helpful way, in a way that may help that person know themselves better. And then the self is freed for further work. Now, we're only in the middle of the session, and I'm talkative. So instead of pushing through and running through the next six questions or seven here, which is not possible, even this session will now become 2 hours. And so why don't we call it a day here? And next time we'll pick up here at 61.7, which gives us a lot of time and is a leisurely approach, because the next question, 61.7, pertains to feelings affecting portions of body, feelings and sensations, the second skanda. Five skandhas, form, feeling. Ra's perspective on the activity of feeling or sensation in body, and how bodily manifestation, you know, symptoms and body conditions manifest mind states, mind fields, or mental activity distorted and clear. So we'll start with that next time, and we'll get a deeper understanding of body and the healing and balancing of the body complex, which is not just physical, and then some more discussion of catalyst and third density and balancing. So I think we'll have enough for another full hour. In any case, I hope this was helpful. I appreciate everybody being here. It's helpful for me. Take good care of yourselves and see you next time. Okay, good night.